Welcome back. I'm Paige Bailey, and this is
Laurence Maroney.
And we are here to answer all of your Ask TensorFlow questions at the TensorFlow Dev Summit. So if you have any questions, please submit them to social media with the hashtag AskTensorFlow.
And we'll answer as many of them as we can, but any that we can't get to today, we'll try to reach out to you later to answer them.
Absolutely. So let's get started with the first question.
Okay, so shall I try this one?
Yeah, absolutely.
So this one I think came on Twitter from Hugo, and it said, once I installed TensorFlow GPU, import didn't work for me. Been trying to use it, but has been unable to do so. It fails to load native TensorFlow runtime. I remember seeing this one, and actually it was on YouTube, and it was in response to one of my videos about pip install TensorFlow GPU in Colab, because once upon a time in Colab, you had to pip install TensorFlow GPU to be able to use it, and now if you try to do that, you end up having some issues. Yeah. And the reason for that is actually really good, and it's good news, and it's because you don't need to do it anymore.
Excellent.
So if we switch to Colab for a second on my laptop, I can show you. This was the notebook that I was showing earlier on. And all you have to do if you want to use GPU in Colab is just change your runtime type, pick GPU as the hardware accelerator, and now you don't need to pip install TensorFlow GPU. It actually does it for you under the hood behind the scenes. So it's really, really cool. And that's why earlier I was able to train this so quickly, because I was actually using the GPU. And as you can see, there's no pip install GPU on here.
Excellent. Right? So. Whenever we were initially testing TensorFlow 2.0, we had a kind of similar issue as well with the GPU install, in that you needed specific CUDA drivers.
Yep.
But now CUDA 10 is supported in Colab as well.
Yep.
So Colab is a great experience if you're using a GPU or if you're using any other accelerated hardware.
Yep, and a pro tip going forward as well, if you want to do GPU stuff, because this was something that I ran into a number of times when trying to use the GPU, was that you always have to carefully take a look at the version of CUDA and CUDNN that you're using, because I made the mistake that I just went to the vendor's website, I downloaded the latest versions, I installed them, and then I saw TensorFlow was actually supporting a slightly earlier version.
Yeah.
So if you do get an error when you're trying to use GPU, just take a look at the version of the driver that it's looking to support, and then from the vendor's website, download that specific version.
Yep. Driver issues.
They're always a
treat, right?
Exactly. And it's like it's one of the things that makes our job interesting.
Right? Absolutely.
All right. So shall we take a look at the next one?
Yeah, let's go. Oh, AD Kumar. So AD Kumar had at least eight excellent questions on Twitter. AD
wins the volume award.
He absolutely does. And we'll get to all of them, not in this sort of Ask TensorFlow segment, but let's focus on just one for today and then answer the rest offline.
Yeah, and I think a lot of them were really about file formats and how do I use different file formats. So shall we drill into that?
Absolutely. So the question is, which is the preferred format for saving the model going forward, SavedModel or something else? And if we look at the laptop, we can take a gander at one of the slides from the keynote this morning, really showing that Keras is a first-class citizen in TensorFlow 2.0, and SavedModel is at the heart of every deployment. So here you can see SavedModel being used for TensorFlow Serving, for TensorFlow Lite, for TensorFlow JS, and lots of other language bindings. So really, we're pushing for the SavedModel.
Yeah. And if you focus on SavedModel, you can't go wrong.
Yes, absolutely.
Right,
it's a lot easier to use than some of the other deployment options that we'd seen before.
Yeah. So I think the guidance would be in the recommendation, not just for AD, but for everybody else. And when you're thinking about saving out your models, take a look at SavedModel, consider using SavedModel. And as a result, it's like not only is the advantage of the file format, but just how it's supported across all of these things.
And an excellent point of TensorFlow 2.0, I'm just going to keep selling it,
is
that we have a number of code samples and tutorials available today about how you can deploy your models with SavedModel.
Yeah. And I personally found, like, from playing with some of the TensorFlow Lite stuff in 2.0, saving as a saved model and then going through the conversion to the TF-Lite process, it was a lot easier for me than in previous iterations where I had to use like Toco Converter and all that kind of stuff. So it's it's really been refined. We're really iterating on that. And I think it looks really cool. So.
Yeah.
All right.
Excellent.
So thanks for all of those questions, AD. There's some great stuff in there. Mm-hmm. We will try to answer some of the rest of them, but understood that most of them were focused around the file format. And hopefully SavedModel will help you.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Perfect. So let's go to the next one.
So this next one comes from Eli Gakuba, And asking, is it possible to run TensorBoard on Colabs? And I know this made Paige really happy.
Oh, dude, you were going to be so delighted.
Because before TensorBoard was running on Colabs, you know, we were like talking about it. We really wanted on Colabs.
It was so painful. Like the, if you wanted to get it working in a Colab notebook or in Jupyter, you ended up using a tool like ngrok, and that was kind of not approved by our bosses or in general. So the good news is that you can run TensorBoard and Colab.
And when it was first announced internally in Google before it was publicly announced, we all got this email from Paige, and it was full of all these smiley emojis and hearts. You know, it was like, Ely, thank you for the question, because I think you've made Paige's day.
Excellent. And so you can see here in the Colab, I'm running through and sort of downloading some files in the hope that we could play with it a little bit. But here you can see it actually working. You should be able to do different operations like smoothing, changing some of the values, and then also making, using the embedding visualizer directly from your Colab notebook in order to understand kind of your accuracies and to be able to do model performance debugging. Another nice thing that the team has been working very, very hard on is that you don't have to specify ports. So you don't have to remember if you wanted to have multiple TensorBoard instances running that you were using, 6006 or whatever for another. It just automatically selects one that would be a good candidate and creates it for you. So the team is phenomenal. If you have any interest whatsoever in TensorBoard at all, I suggest stalking their PRs like I do, because that's how I found out that TensorBoard got added to Jupyter Notebooks and also to Colab.
Yep.
It's so excited. And we'll have this link in the documentation for the video as well, the little notes underneath
for you to go and play with. And I do have to say, it's so great to have a PR stalker in our group.
Dude, I get push notifications to my phone, it's a problem. But yeah, they've been doing such great work.
Yep. So the question is, yes, TensorBoard is working in Colab.
And also Project Jupyter Notebooks. Nice. Use it wherever.
Yep.
TensorBoard everywhere.
TensorBoard everywhere, and we all love TensorBoard. I haven't really played with it that much, but do a lot of the plugins also work?
So right now, TensorBoard really is a collection of these different visualizations. So you can see scalars, like your accuracy, you can see histograms, you can see embedding visualizers, which allows you to do clustering, like that great MNIST example from the Dev Summit a couple of years ago. Moving it around.
I play with that all day.
Yeah, it's beautiful. And then also Beholder, which was created by a community member. The plugins, it's so funny you mention it. A couple of our GSOC, Google Summer of Code projects this summer, are focused on getting additional visualization plugins added to TensorBoard.
Cool.
So
nice.
In addition to the What If tool, in addition to Beholder, you could make your own TensorBoard plugin.
So while I could geek out about this all day, I think we should move on to some other questions.
Are you sure we can't geek out about
I know. Yeah, can we extend the stream for 3 or 4 hours? So the next question that came in from Amar Hussein Harandi, how would you use feature columns with Keras?
And I know you know the answer to this question.
But I know that's a particular passion of yours, that you're working with estimators in Keras. So for the folks who are watching, feature columns are really a part of estimators, right? They're a way of really getting your data efficiently into estimators. And with people saying, hey, it's all there in estimators, what about Keras?
Yeah.
And you've been working on some great stuff around that, right?
I have, but I know that your YouTube channel has a series from Carmel, who spoke earlier today.
Yeah, so Carmel is our engineering director for high-level APIs, and she has this great series around high-level APIs for TensorFlow. And so really, really teaching you how to use the high-level APIs. And Carmel is working actively, and her team are working actively for parity of things like feature columns in TensorFlow 2. I'm not sure if it's fully there yet in the alpha. I haven't checked into it yet. Mm-hmm. But it's on the way if it's not there already. So you should be able to use them in Keras.
Yes, and we're also in the process of building out, if you wanted to migrate your models from using estimators to being more of a TensorFlow 2.0 format with Keras, I am currently in the process of building a migration guide. So if you have any interest around that, Please feel free to reach out, and we're excited to get that released pretty soon.
I'm really excited to see that personally, because the very first stuff I did in TensorFlow was with estimators before I learned Keras.
Yeah.
And I really want to go back and kind of start changing them to use Keras without rewriting them.
So, absolutely. So. Keras is just friendlier to work with, I feel.
Yeah, they're both great estimators, really gives you the power. Keras, great for beginners. So it's like, hopefully we'll get the best of both worlds. So it's like, so shall we take a look at the next question?
Yes.
And Jeff Thomas asks, looking for some simple data sets for testing and comparing different training methods. Looking for new data sets, like MNIST is great, Fashion MNIST is great, but after a while, people want something new and fresh, right?
Yes.
So what can you think we can say to Jeff?
We could tell them about TensorFlow datasets.
And there's a great blog post right here about it.
Yes, it is. And TensorFlow datasets is really about creating those data ingestion, pipelines for you to be able to easily use a variety of datasets with all of your deep learning and machine learning models with just a few lines of code. So if you're familiar with scikit-learn and all of its sort of nifty data ingestion practices, this feels very similar. It's very easy to do training and testing splits and verification splits. And we have a lot of data sets readily available right now for you to go and explore. Another thing that I would especially like to call out is a member of our community. So anybody can make your data famous, right? Like if you have a data set that you're using in your research lab, if you have like a bright and shiny CSV that you think would be a cool add to the structured
section. I've never
heard
a CSV called bright and shiny before.
Well, you know, everybody uses them. So, but it's the one of our community members, Andrew Kondrick, who's an undergrad researcher at Stanford. He added this Chexpert data set from his lab, 200,000 chest radiograms.
Wow.
From the Stanford ML group, and he was able to do it in like less than a day. Like it really
Crazy.
Is just as simple as take the template format for images or for audio or whatever you're using, add some additional metadata for the data set, change potentially the types for some of the features that you're using within it, and voila, there
you're
you go.
Off to the races.
Absolutely, and you can make your data famous.
Yep, and one of the really important things about it, particularly if you're getting started or if you're learning, is that if you take a look at a lot of the samples pre-TensorFlow datasets, there tends to be lots and lots of code about download your data, unzip it here, label it like this, put these files in these folders, or take your CSV and make these features. But when it's in TFDS, it's like one or two lines of code and the data will just get sorted into training and test sets for you, that type of thing. And so I think for learners in particular, I found it like really, really exciting because I didn't have to go through 100 lines of code before I got to the neural network.
And also data science-y people. Like so much of creating and training a model is understanding the shape and the format and sort of the statistical distributions. And this is really helpful.
Yep. So thanks very much.